I will call the roll first of the board and then of the facilities task force so that everybody knows who everybody is. Jesse Jones?
Here.
Barry Miller?
Here.
Barry Samuels?
There you go, you're welcome.
Caroline? And Katrina Barber?
Here.
Kathleen Lee?
Here.
Dorothea Marcus? Stuart Auchincloss? Jeffrey Hanowitz?
Here.
Amy Raff? Eliza Kunkel? Sean Ritchie? Joe Mangan? Jerry Washington? Marty Nystrom? Tim Moore? We're all here. That is to say, all who is going to be here. Esther Ratner has served on the facilities task force, and she is in rehabilitation with a couple of broken vertebrae. I don't know just how they broke, but that's where Esther is. And the other members of the facilities task force who aren't here are in warm southern climates. And she's also a facilities task force. So, I circulated an agenda earlier, which was on the library website. I'd entertain a motion to approve it. Or if you want to change it. So moved by Dorothea, second by Kathleen to approve the agenda as sent out. Any discussion? All in favor, aye. Opposed, nay.
I have a question. I didn't see an ending time on the agenda. I was wondering if we have a set ending time.
We don't have a set ending time. All right, the agenda's approved. So the first thing is the introduction of the final report from the Facilities Task Force to the Library Board, and then conversation between the Facilities Task Force and the Library Board about the final report. And after that conversation has gone for a while, we'll open it up to questions and answers from everybody or anybody who wants to speak about it. And that will be the substance of our meeting tonight. I don't expect the Library Board to make any important decisions about the Facilities Task Force report tonight, but I do expect, I know that we'll discuss it at our regular meeting on February 19th, the third Thursday. It starts at 7 o'clock. So, does anyone on the Facilities Task Force want to say anything in introduction? The report has been on the library website for over a week.
Bring it on.
Oh, sure. Sorry. Amy reminded me that there are two or three copies, printed copies of the report. If you've looked at it on the website, you know that it's 60 pages, and we didn't make too many copies. It also is much better if you have the PDF, because you can jump around in it and find the parts that you're interested in. That's on the library website. This is the agenda. And if anybody would like to speak, I have six people who've signed up, and if anyone else wants to, after those six, we'll move on to that rest of the audience. So I'm going back now to the Facilities Task Force to my invitation to anyone who wants to say anything in introduction.
Bring it on. I'd like to say for all the members of our task force, Maria, who is the co-chair, is not able to be here, that the experience was really quite wonderful. And most of you, or I think probably all of you, were not at all of our meetings. But what started out as could have been a very contentious task force was unanimous in almost every decision that was made. In fact, I don't remember that we ever took a vote, and almost everything was by consensus. It was certainly my privilege, and I think everyone else would agree on the committee, that this was sort of a one-in-a-lifetime experience of bonding together, of analyzing the situation, and coming up with decisions. And I'm pleased, I'm sure everyone else is pleased to serve, and I just wanted to emphasize the fact that this report is a pretty strong report, and there wasn't a lot of controversy within the group during the study.
Thanks, Marty. Anybody else over here? All right. Tim.
I just want to second what Marty said. Many of the faces that I remember coming to our meetings are here, and I want to thank you for coming. and being so dedicated to seeing what was going on and being able to verify, can't remember, it's a C word.
Consensus.
Agree. Verify that we, and you'll come up with the word soon.
Corroborate.
If you're able to corroborate that the meetings were held with a lot of thought. We were very methodic, looking through all the issues that are covered in the report. And it was, as Marty said, a really great experience to see something happen as methodically and as thoroughly without a lot of contention. A lot of events led up to the beginning, to the formation of this, and to our conclusions. So I want to ask that you take it in the spirit in which you did this. I think that everybody, no matter how they were feeling and what letters they were writing to the paper, are pro-library and really want the best to happen for the library. And that's the spirit that we brought to this report. So as we return it into the board and as you ask Q&A, please speak up now about any reservations you have, any questions you have. We really want to be able to answer your questions. This is the last time these people will be together.
Thanks, Tim. Ask the questions?
Anybody from the board want to either say anything or ask any questions or make any observations about this report?
Well, I think it's a good report. You guys did a very thorough job, and I think that there's still some, you put out the report and you made your recommendations, and then the board needs to, go ahead with whatever we decide to do. And we need to look at the details and stuff. So, like Stuart said, we're not going to make any big decisions tonight. I guess on my part, it's nice to have a report. It's nice to have something from all of you that also gives space for people that were really excited about the annex to give us space to look at an alternative, because emotionally that's a huge project to have to shift gears and look at something else. So I think because this report is really neutral, it's easier to consider that, and I appreciate that.
Thanks. Others? Yeah, Dorothea.
I went to a lot of the facilities task force meetings, for about the first half or two-thirds of when you met, and I was very impressed with everyone's commitment, and how hard everyone worked, and I think it's a great report. I think it's very thoughtful and considered, and I have a question, towards the end of your deliberations and also the last few board meetings, we've had people talking about, looking at an even bigger picture, and you touch on it in the report, that if, money were no object, if we could just build a new library, there's been talk about the lower Camo parking lot site and, things like that. And you say that it would be so much more expensive, and but I'm curious if any of you on the task force, because if we end up having to do a bond, the idea of adding a north wing to a building that's, so obsolete. I just wondered, if any of you want to comment on the prospect of just building a whole new library. Eliza?
Well, I think we do more than touch on it. I think we make the case that once you guys went to once you started thinking about a budget of, over $1.5 million, that there's a lot more you could get for that than in terms of space than the Joel Sanders Annex. And we tried to look at what was realistic financially, what we thought was financially realistic. We ran the numbers for you in the addendum on what an entirely new library would cost. We thought it was probably more than anyone would want to take on right now. And the advantage of, I think we explained a couple times in the report that we think the advantage of starting with the north wing is that it can serve as the anchor for the next project. You know, if and when the day comes, 10, 20, 50 years from now, when the existing library building is no longer functional, you have a 6,000 square foot building that can serve as an interim library while a larger construction project happens. But, you know, I think, back to the earlier comment, you know, we tried to make this report empowering to the board, not emasculating. And there's a lot of decisions that you guys have to make, and there's a lot of options. And, you know, if you think the town can support a, you know, if you think there's enough support for a whole new library, you know, that's up to you. I mean, we presented some numbers, and you know, that's something you're gonna have to decide. We think it's, we think you could probably get by for some time with a smaller project.
Okay, thank you.
Let me add to that too. The I think the critical issue is the master plan. Is if you do have a new library eventually, you have to decide where it's gonna be. And it would be a shame if you built the annex and decided 5 years from now that maybe the library shouldn't be there anymore, it should be someplace else. And that would be a bit of a disaster. So the part of the master plan is really to set a long-range plan that the board can set forth what they're going to do with the property. And if the master plan decision we made is to keep the library and the property you have, the wing in the back can be built to be the first phase of a new building. So it can be, you can actually do a schematic design or conceptual design of a whole new library and have the wing built as standalone, ready to be combined later on with the newer building. So having that vision of the future and then incorporating that into your design of the wing, I think is critical for the next step. That becomes your anchor if you're going to build a new library on the same site. And it allows you considerable flexibility when you do take down the old building. You probably would still have to move some library functions off site, but you would have the opportunity to keep some critical library functions there in the new wing, and have the engineering system still have power and heat and air conditioning. So to me, the stepping back and doing a master plan of which one eventually really then directs your decisions from then on.
Good, thank you.
Yeah. Question. Mm-hmm. Jeffrey.
I believe, Marty, it was your vision about moving the library?
Yeah, I was going to.
I just would like you know, for you to expound on why you would think that we would ever need to move the library.
Why would we ever need to?
Yeah, why you think a master plan might suggest
a new site.
That we would, a new site.
Yeah. Well, I've expressed concern continually about the existing library and it being a potential sinkhole of money. It's really rather not a great space. Some people feel it's historic, and I think it's more nostalgic than historical, though certainly the front of the doctor's office is historic, bar none. My thought had been, would it be wonderful to move the entire library over to the lower Camo parking lot? Parking is there, it's within town, be wonderful. You then have an asset, a piece of property for sale. I was told you're a bit crazy thinking about doing that. We were also very concerned about how much money could reasonably be put in a bond issue. Dollar for dollar, new building is going to be better than renovating that existing building. No question about that. So in the ideal situation, you move to another site, you sell this site for its assessed valuation of, I don't know, $1 million, $1.5 million. I think it's at $1 million right now. But if you can't raise the money, if you can't get a bond issue big enough to support a new library, then you're stuck with what you have. So you do a phasing plan. You start with the most buildable area and then decide what's going to happen later. I think what's going to happen is if you do build that, we're going to grow into it and things are going to change. Just since the 2007 report, there have been changes in the use of the library, the computers, et cetera. So it's a moving target. It is a moving target, the function. And I think that will evolve. So I'm happy with what you can get, which is 6,000 square feet, on the existing site and save for phase two, laundromat site, the front of the library, and the deposit, and whatever happens with the existing building. Is that, did that answer your question?
Not really.
No, good, give it to me.
Because Mr. Magnin suggested that we need to do a master plan.
Yeah.
And that maybe a master plan would suggest that we move the library.
Let me answer that. I think the master plan, to start with, is not something that somebody kind of does to you. It's something that you're like totally involved with. It's you get together. And to me, the master plan would raise the issue, should we move the library?
And the question I have is why would we consider moving the library?
Well, it's a good question. And I think, I was just in Manchester, Vermont, and they have a great old library. And it's stone, it's really pretty, and they've expanding it. And now they're landlocked because it's right where two streets come together. And they need more room. And they just decided that they have to sell the library and build a new one because they're just stuck. They can't do anything with it. We're not in that situation.
Manchester's a major city, isn't it?
No, it's pretty small. I think it's bigger than Woodstock and not a lot bigger. But the point is that when you're doing a master plan, before you build anything, you should decide what the long-term plan is. And if the long-term plan is no, we're not going to build a new library somewhere else, this is where we are, then you can take that off the table. But the master plan begs the decision, is it on the table or not? And if it's off the table, then you forget about it, and then you start construction as if you're going to stay here forever on that property. But you have to make that decision, because 5 years or 10 years down the road, you don't want to suddenly discover it was a better idea to move. Because it's too late then, because you invest a lot of capital. So it's really what the cumulative we decide, we meaning the board, the architects, and town input, what's the best thing. Personally, I don't think you're going to move the library. I wouldn't expect you to. But it's worth the discussion and the conclusion that would follow to set a long-term plan.
Got it. Thank you.
Did you have a follow-up, Marty?
No.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Just a moment.
Just
let me make
procedure.
Sure that the board is somewhat done, and then
my question is just on the procedure of what you're planning to do tonight. That's all.
Well, we have an agenda if you want to look at it.
You mean what we're planning to do this evening, or
with this?
We're planning to talk about it and so make sure that the board understands the FTF final report well.
Okay.
That's the goal of this meeting. And any back and forth between the board and the FTF, that's how we're starting, and then perhaps you all will help us understand it even better.
Okay.
That's the procedure for tonight. Barry.
Yeah. I was surprised how well this document read and the amount of work, considering all the distractions that are all over the place from the Woodstock Times, and I want to thank you for how easy it read and for the amount of work you did. I had no idea. I know you were meeting every week and so forth, but I had no idea the amount of work that you did. I think the most important thing that I see that came out of the task force is that there are new eyes looking at this, and in some cases, the expert eyes with certain expertise that we didn't have to look at. And I think that was the beginning of how, you know, I see personally how the progression is going to go about the decision and so forth. I know I was influenced by a lot of your investigations and so forth. And I appreciate this. And I think the first thing we should do is hire a consultant, maybe not a whole architectural firm or something, a consultant who has expertise in libraries, and we should go from there. I think that's the first thing we do, give them all the information that we have, all the task force report and so forth. I did have a question, which is, concerning the mistrust of the library board in the town, especially with the MOU, and especially with the rumors that the library board knew that the annex design exceeded the footprint before it asked for the MOU. And the town board felt that that they were snookered, as if something underhanded had taken place. Did you go and investigate, and you know, whether this was true, that we were all underhandedly, you know, knowing that the design of the Sanders design was going to exceed the footprint? Were you interested in finding out whether these rumors were
true? It wasn't really our charge.
It was not really our charge, Barry.
Yeah.
And, this you know, we had, our charge was to look at the 2007 study to reflect on that as it applied to the annex and to the existing building. And I, as opposed to maybe some of the other fellows, had more emotional tie to the existing building, because I believe fundamentally that you fix what you got instead of building something new that replaces something that's still worthwhile.
Okay,
that's the point being that that may be a little cut off the subject of the question. But no, we did not.
Because you did some investigation in the MOU and you made statements about the MOU.
We did not go in to see if there was any shenanigans going on or anything of that sort.
Looking at it, I think we concluded that, I don't know what word I should use, but we saw nothing underhanded. We saw people miscommunicated, that they held out ideas, even new ideas were being presented. And I don't think there was any real point of clarity. There was always like different groups had different ideas at the time. And some of those ideas became obsolete. We went back, or I went back and looked when Amy presented at the town board meeting. And I don't think there was anything that was held back. I think it was just everybody didn't realize what was going on at the same time and concluded the same thing. So I think we concluded it was a misunderstanding, and maybe it's not really worth revisiting, because there was no smoking gun. There was no outright, I think, anybody misleading somebody else. So
the town board thought it was important. So. That,
yeah.
That we did something. Slippery.
Well, I think things just changed, and everybody didn't realize what was changing at the time.
Okay.
So
I just to state that would have been.
So I'm sure there was people that, you know, maybe, you know, fueled the fire a little bit, but there was no overt, like the board tried to pull a major fast one. You know,
no,
we,
I didn't,
we didn't say that.
But it would be nice to say that, is what, right. When you talked about the MOU and all the rumors that were going on. Just to continue the investigation, saying there were no basis for these rumors.
I see Eliza, and I think I saw Marty. No, Tim.
Yeah.
Okay. Eliza, and then Tim also wanted to speak to this question.
Barry, it just wasn't our scope to settle that. I think there was a lot of. To me, there was a lot of CYA by the town board when the uproar happened. They were like, I think there was a lot of finger pointing that was unfair, frankly, but it wasn't our scope to investigate it. So what we said about the MOU was really more of an acknowledgement that there is this problem, but our problem, what we were charged with was trying to make a recommendation on how the library should solve its space issues. We weren't charged with conducting an investigation of a timeline of who knew what when, and it just seems counterproductive. I wish this cloud hadn't formed, and I wish that people could move forward in good faith, and I hope that they will.
I realize this wasn't your job, that wasn't your job, but just to maybe. Work on the trust that the board showed in this whole process would have been an interesting part of your report.
Well, I can tell you from my experience, I was really impressed by the way the board sat back and let us do our work without interference. I wish that I could say the same for the most vocal opponents of the annex, but that's not the case. I think I was really surprised and pleased that you guys gave us as much room as we needed to ask the questions we did. I know that it must have been difficult for the library board members from the FTF to watch us go over the same ground that they felt they, you know, had already covered, but they let us do it, and they let us do our work, and you know, so I was very pleased with the hands-off approach that the library board took to our process.
I understand that. That's a good answer. Yeah.
Tim, did you?
Yeah, Barry, thanks for bringing it up. I will say, and most people who were at the meetings that we had will notice that at times we did chafe at some of the prosecutorial heat that was on the board and on us. The heat much more on the board because of past events. I once said that people had come in late on this, and I wanted to draw the public's attention, and the board already knows this, but there's a section 2 in this report called Background, and it goes all the way back to the 2007 feasibility study. And then in section B, it talks about the 5-year plan of service, which the outreach for started in 2010. And there was a whole series of events by which there was outreach to the town, and a lot of input was given by the people who did participate. But the buzz around it has gotten much bigger, partially because of the contention. So a lot more people are involved, and we're getting a lot more input than happened then. But it doesn't change the fact that the board and all the task forces and committees of the board did since 2010 to try to move toward a new building or a new extension for the library, as it manifested in the annex, was invalid or it was a thorough process that happened between 2010 and 2012. One of the pieces that I think was missing was was more architectural input in there, and we've covered that in the recommendation for a master plan going forward. And I just wanted to say also that in section C of, well, in any case, on page 21, there's lessons to be learned from the Socrates Library renovation and addition. And it talks about how architects were brought on board to do a pre-design study. And you might want to take a look at that. The public can take a look at it, too. It's a nice precedent. It's a different situation. Woodstock is a colony of the arts. They did a full program around their Socrates being a recreational kind of town. But there's lessons to be learned from this, and also from the process that you guys went through between 2010 and 2012. But I think the sentiment at the FTF was, we'd really like to see the prosecutorial heat from that has preceded all of this to turn down and let the board really do its work at this point.
Marty, I saw your hand.
Barry, to your point about looking back, our attempt from the beginning was to look forward. What had happened in the past happened in the past. We had enough work to do to get to where we are today to just move forward. I wanted to mention, just go back about this notion about, or this notion about new building. When we talk about a master plan, there is one logical place most likely to build. That doesn't mean that one can't combine the two and do phase one and phase two at the same time right away, if there is the money. And finally, I wanted to mention about the library site, about the laundromat site. It is agreed by everyone that it was a very logical and wise choice to acquire that property. I think that we would, on both sides of the issue of the Joel Sanders Annex, I think we would all agree that it's a visionary building. People might not like the way it looks or whatever, but it makes an environmental statement. It might be expensive, it might not be, but somewhere along the line, this visionary design got to where it is, and we just have to go forward from here.
Anyone else? All right. Opening up the meeting to everybody then, and the first name I have on the speaking list is John Ludwig.
Could I say something on this board?
Oh, sure. Hang on a second, John.
In general, we're really looking for a Q&A more than comments, and also not looking for, we're not here to garner effusive praise for the FTF. That's really just a way of slamming the board. So we're looking for questions and constructive dialogue, and I would urge you all to keep that in mind. Thanks.
Yes, before we go into the public, I want to just personally thank all of you for all the tremendous amount of time and effort and energy that you guys put into this. And I want you to know that we're going to pick it apart piece by piece, and we're going to look at everything, because that's what we're supposed to do.
Great.
And I really, really appreciate everything that you guys have done. Thank you.
Okay, and I have an email from Doris Goldberg, who is actually very far south in Cuba right now with her husband. She's a member of the library board, and she asked that that this be read aloud to you. And she said, although I cannot be present at tonight's meeting, I want to go on the record that I've read the Facility Task Force's 60-page report and intend to read it again several times before the next library board meeting. The volunteers comprising the FTF obviously have put forth much time and effort in making a recommendation that they feel will benefit our town. Be assured that the library board will take this work seriously and consider it carefully as it decides how best to proceed.
Thanks. Anybody else before we hear from John Ludwig? John, you have the floor.
Thank you. I've read the FTF report. I think it's an excellent report. The report speaks for itself. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Tara, you're next.
I'm very, very impressed, as you have said you are, the FTF's report and the thoroughness and accuracy of it, and only have one very tiny, tiny little discrepancy I found, which is that there was an assumption on page 6 that the library could have the MOU, and that's still debatable. So I just did want to bring that up, because it's not true that it can have that MOU. It won't really matter if a wing is built on the back of the library, but I think the town board's really emphasized that they gave only permission for something in the same size footprint. Nothing as the annex. And so we have to do some attention to that. And as I said in my letter this week in the Woodstock Times, I've realized that a lot of the Friends of the Library's objection to this was fear that they're going to lose the book barn. So I think it's really incumbent upon the board to think about how to address that issue. Where will the book barn go? Because I think that's a big issue here. They're big supporters of the library. They're doing a wonderful job raising funds. And if we build the wing in the back, the book barn needs a new home somewhere, whether it be on the laundromat or maybe, I don't know how the legality works, but this will be interesting, an issue to address so that there is a book barn somewhere.
Leslie, I'll put your name on the list.
Eliza said, as a response to what I said,
could I answer something?
Sure. Thanks, Eliza. Thank you.
Thanks, Hera. I guess, I'm struck by, you said at the end, you don't know the legality of being able to build for the Friends of the Library, nor do we. And I don't know the legality of the judicial decision. It's not a statute, really. It's a judicial decision, Rochester, Monroe, that was the underpinning for the MOU. But I was impressed that the library board's lawyer and the town board's lawyer both agreed with the reasoning behind it. I was impressed that it was a unanimous vote on both sides. So, you can say that we made an assumption. I don't know. I think you could certainly find a lawyer who will challenge it, because lawyers like to send their kids to private schools like everybody else. So, I think Socrates used that as a reasoning for not having to go in front of the zoning board for their library. I'm not sure that a north wing would make a difference. That's something that the library board and the town board will have to work out. But we're not lawyers, and we tried to steer clear of it.
Thanks. Next on the list is Sam Magarello. Sam Magarello.
Thank you. I want to thank the board for setting up the facilities task force. I think you did an excellent job, as Marty has said a number of times, and others have said that the way you deliberated and worked on this is admirable. And given all the heat that you've mentioned, it's good to have at least one place in town where there seems to be some healthy communication and holding up of ideas and trying to come up with what would be the best way to proceed based on facts. So I want to thank the board for setting this whole operation in process. As far as the MOU, what I heard was that the facilities task force did not address that. And so I think it's unfair to say that it's been settled or that there's no advice about it. That remains to be determined. But if the library follows your recommendations and builds an addition, then it's moot as to the whole MOU, which I think would save the taxpayers a lot of money and actually provide more services for the community, library services, in a faster amount of time. One of the things I wanted to ask you about was, I didn't see it in the report, and maybe you can help me understand this, but I was hoping to see for the amount of money that was being considered to be spent on the annex, how much could you get with the addition? Because right now, I think the community is thinking in terms of the annex at 1.5, and then they hear a much larger project that is larger. If one of your little points or notes would have been helpful, that if the library were to spend the same amount of money on the annex, what could they get on the site, just to help people understand what the comparative value is. I think that would be very helpful. Clearly, if all the interested parties, instead of banging heads about this, can find what they have in common, we can certainly move forward and bring the community along with raising money. I have one other concern, just a point of fact, actually. In the facts, and we frequently ask questions, I think it was number two, it made reference to the town hall and the community center having cost overruns. And that's not true. What has happened with both projects is that when they put forth what the amount of money was for the bonding, and they sent out the bids, all the bids came back higher than what they thought it was going to be. And so when they tried to pare it down, they realized that they had to add more money to the initial proposal. And so it was an estimate problem through the town and through the contractors. When they got into the town hall, there were no cost limits. They figured out ways to cut other costs so that they could come in the budget. And they're doing the same thing with the community center. They made some adjustments and actually moved things around to save quite a few $1,000s. Yes, there are some increased costs, but they are far outweighed by their frugal effort to keep the construction within budget. So whoever added that piece into the report, I would encourage that maybe, well, it's too late now, I assume we're done with this, so it's going to go on to the board, but I would encourage the board not to rely on that sentence, that maybe speak to the town board and get a more current report on the alleged cost overruns. But in fact, it was an initial estimate that needed to be upgraded. And since the estimate was upgraded, there were no cost overruns, net cost overruns. So there are gives and takes as you go along, but if you keep within the total amount, you don't have cost overruns. So, thanks again. I hope that what you've learned in this process, you can continue to share, and maybe there'll be other opportunities to use your approach. And thank you. Thank you very much.
So let me address that. Oh, sure, thanks. We did try to repair program space in the annex and program space in addition to the back. And on page 17 is a graph. And that cost per square foot of program space. And that's not building space. That's actual program space. And in the annex, it cost about $1,200 a square foot for program space. In the addition, it cost about $455, which is considerably less than half, almost a third. And the reason for that, and put made it clear in the report, is not a shortcoming of Sanders' design. But when you have a small building and you need bathrooms and mechanical rooms and ramps and all that, you wind up, you just don't have any economy of scale. So there's only 1,190 square foot of actual program space in the annex. And it's a function of the property. You can't fit a bigger building and do what you're going to do there. And in the rear, there's the economy of scale and the ramps and all that, but the $455 compared to $1,208 a square foot in the annex is a fair comparison, not of buildings or designs, just of budgeting. If you need that much square foot, what's it going to cost with your different alternatives? That's going to be looked at. But once again, it's not a critique of Sanders. It's just the nature of a small building versus a larger building. And also the thing that because you're building on the floodplain and you elevate, the annex is elevated, you have a lot of inherent costs with ramps and lifts and things like that that you don't have in the rear of the library. So it's just different parameters for construction. But that is a comparison of the two.
Eliza. Thanks, Joe.
I think that if you want to know what you can get for $1.5 million, other than the annex, the solution is to talk to a master planning architect. And I think that a master planner would present the board with, you know, what else you could get for $1.5 million. We were trying to solve all the space needs, not some of the space needs. And so we didn't do schematic drawings of everything. We tried to give reasonable cost estimates, and that's where we are. You know, we left it open that if they want to keep the budget at $1.5 million, again, we say work with a master planner and come up with a first stage, a second stage, a third stage. As for your issue of cost overruns, Sam, I got to say, I think you protest a little too much. I've heard two different town board members use the term overruns. I think the Woodstock Times would have some questions about it. You can mention, you say something like price increases, but that's somehow different than a cost overrun, whatever. That's not our job. We're trying to help the library, and you know, it's immaterial, and the report's final.
Marty.
Sam, this point about cost overruns, it's, I think really what we're talking about are unforeseen conditions that happen. So you have a budget, you work to that budget, when you come upon a foundation problem, so you give up a folding wall for now to solve the problems that you come upon. That's what I get so concerned about that existing building, because there's such a potential of how do we reinforce that basement floor? What do we do with the floor? How do we handle the air conditioning of the place? How do we handle the lighting? There's so many things that it could be a sinkhole, and I think that I don't think it's correct to say that there were cost overruns at the community center, but there were unforeseen conditions, which I can see happening here also. And also in figuring cost per square foot, I think it's easy to figure new cost per square foot, but how much do you lay into the old building? Is it 50 a foot? Is it 75 a foot? Is it 175 a foot? Goodness knows.
Actually, though, that's another piece. In all of these conversations and comments, there seems to be some allusion to the fact that we're actually trying to do something for the old library, other than the, some of the infrastructure. But the standalone north wing, there are many benefits from not touching the old building. And I think, I'm not so sure if many people understand that. That we're not, you're not suggesting that we are fixing the old library while we do this north wing. It's a standalone one that's being suggested. And so that eliminates a lot of the cost and issues that cropped up in the 07. And so for those people who are thinking that we're looking at, yes, we want to address the infrastructure, including electric ventilation and all those issues, and mitigating the mold and so on. But those are far different from renovating.
I have Jeffrey and Barry, who both wanted to speak, and then I will come to Joe. So
you were, I was going to address what was just said, unless you were.
So was I.
Well,
okay.
I think. What about it, Jeffrey?
I just have some information. If you want to address what he just said, that's fine. I can.
Okay.
Well, how about Barry was
Barry
next? I saw his hand before yours.
Sam, I heard you say that a standalone building. That's not what we were. We were thinking about a large building in the back attached to the main building. Not a standalone building. Okay, and I'm going to say this because I've been doing this for 14 years at the library. I've been through at least five interviews with architects talking about redesigning the library. The idea of putting something where the barn is came up 15 years ago in conversation. What are we going to do in the back? The barn is getting old. What are we going to do? In 2007, the architects that we hired built libraries. That's what one of the main things that they did as an architectural firm. They came up with a master plan to raise our library up two stories and go back at the cost of $6 million. But that was a complete overhaul of the library, complete overhaul. All the things that people are complaining about that are wrong with it would have been taken care of. Would have been taken care of. Plus, we would have had more space. In terms of the programming changing, we have a new director. Time is changing, so we're thinking more technology, involving more areas in the library for that, for programming. But that was a whole library that was built, not just plopping a building down in the back. You can't put a building there. It needs heat. It needs to be attached to the main building. It's got to be careful when you read things and not to misrepresent it as terms of what you think you want. What we're looking at is possibly a building in the back attached to the main building, connecting the heating. There has to be also a site, a vision from the main building to the back. You can't let people go into a back building with nobody watching it and walk out. That needs to be, it's called circulation. These are things that people that work in libraries understand. That's what I meant when he wrote in the paper when I said people don't understand. What I'm saying is when you work from the inside out, when you work in the library and you know how libraries work, you know what libraries need. And I'm sure the people who have been on the facilities task force learned a lot during this whole process. I've been through it four times or five times with different architects. And we've had some really good master architects working with us. So I just want to make that point that in 2007, that was an entire renovation, the entire library at $6 million. So it's not just the building in the back.
Thanks. And Joe, you wanted to speak to the concept.
Maybe I can clear up some things and reinforce some other points. Number one, I have to say I've spent my whole career doing renovations, mostly in old buildings, 100 years, 200 years old. When I saw the 07 design, I was stunned. To me, it looked like one big change order of taking an old building, ripping it apart, and trying to combine a new building. I thought it was going to be like really difficult and really expensive. And they did have a huge construction contingency. I thought it was a bad idea and said so, I think, at several board meetings. Now let me address the issue of standalone, because maybe that means different things to different people. When I use the word standalone, it doesn't mean a building off in a field by itself. In the context of what we're talking about on the library property, is a building that's erected structure.